Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Adult Chair on Rash Pixel FM. I'm Pete Wright. We're back after a little bit of time off for the Thanksgiving holiday. I'm sitting right here with Michelle Chalfant. Hello, Michelle.
Hi, Pete. Did you have a nice Thanksgiving?
Yes, always do. Always eat too much, and it's delightful. I'm sick and proud of it.
Excellent.
In many ways, this is an interesting connection to the last show we did. It was 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
We spent a lot of time talking about story busting and living in fact and truth. And you know, we wanted to take some time this week and talk a little bit about staying connected to yourself and ending that feeling of overwhelm, specifically during the holidays. Although obviously these are, you know, whatever we're talking about here helps anytime you're feeling overwhelmed. What we find is so many of the people that engage with us are particularly overwhelmed at the holidays, yeah?
Yes, with time constraints, too much to do, none of, you know, all of that.
Where do you start when you're feeling like you are, you know, the overwhelm is coming? And you know, this is where we ended that last conversation. I thought was really good as I went back and listened to it.
Yeah.
What are we talking about? you know, it was this idea, the stories that we create specifically around the holidays are unique to the holidays, you know?
Yeah.
You know, I hope it's not like last year. Oh my gosh. You know, the stories we make up about family we haven't seen in a long time and about how they're going to treat us. What's that experience for you?
I've actually tried to change my experience with the holidays. So when I see a gift, let's just use the examples of gifts, because I used to run out at the last second and like drive myself into major overwhelm when I have to get gifts, like, you know, the week before Christmas. So yeah. Now when I find something that I love for people, even if it's in July, I buy it on the spot. And I have now.
God, you are such a role model.
Yeah. Now I have I have a big, huge bag in my closet in the bedroom. So it's hidden from everybody. And I just throw stuff in there. And if I duplicate it, then sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, I bought two gifts for my sister. Well, one of them I'm going to give to her for her birthday. Okay, great. Because everyone has a birthday and then we have some sort of holiday I have to give someone a gift for. So that's really helped me a lot. Of course, we have some tools that we're going to talk about today with how we stay out of that overwhelm. And it goes back to so much of what we did talk about last week, I have to say. It's the mind that gets us in trouble. So we have a brain and then we have the mind. So the brain is what keeps us alive. The brain is telling us when to blink, when to swallow, to move our legs, things like this. But then we have the mind. It's different. And the mind is feeding us thoughts all day, every day, over 100,000 thoughts a day. Just keep feeding us thoughts. And remember, this part of us is coming from that adolescent chair. It's the average age of a 12-year-old, 12 years old. So it's not these high-level thoughts that are streaming in unconsciously throughout the day. It's just sort of like continues to come in. It's scanning always. It's doing its best to keep us safe. Remember, the ego sits in fear. So it might be judging things, it's judging us. So it's like, what are we paying attention to? So choosing the thoughts that make us feel best is really powerful when it comes to overwhelm. And to remember, this is a big thing we need to remember too, that everything is in divine order, even when something does not look that way. Or so many people think, because I've heard this many, many times, like, why would that happen? It's so bad.
Yeah.
I've heard very religious people come in and say, well, I must have done something wrong because God is punishing me now. I'm like, I'm not going to get into a whole religious talk right now. But in my opinion, again, you know, our soul comes in for all of these different experiences. So when something happens to us, it's not good or bad. And we can stay out of overwhelm. It's just an experience. It's not good or bad. It's just an experience. But we stay out of the overwhelm when we learn to observe the mind. My sister was... this just happened. I'm not laughing because it was not a good thing, but her, I'm looking back on it like, wow, that was a lot of stuff to go through in like a very, very short amount of time. And I was just there visiting her. And the last part was like the cherry on the sundae. So her husband had retinal detachment and like, we weren't sure if he was going to lose his eye. It was a really big deal, but he's actually okay. He's recovering. He's had two surgeries. But while that happened, her father-in-law had just flown in and then everybody got sick on top of it, like major virus, except for my sister. So it was like all this stuff happened. And it was awful. Like I was crying. She was, it was just really like, oh my God, why is this happening? But as we moved on, I was like, okay, oh, I see why that happened, because then this happened and then this happened. Mm-hmm. And I went to visit last week. And we were, again, we're sort of like recovering from all this. And then she had all these neck issues. She's at the doctor for that. It was like, again, one thing after the next. And then she and I went down to Charleston to do a writing trip. We were both writing these books. And I said, okay, we're getting ready to leave. The day before we're leaving, she opens up her freezer and her freezer isn't working. So I'm like, she's like, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? She was so mad. And that was when I realized, after she's telling me all these events that had gone down just in the last 4 weeks, it was crazy. I said to her, I said, oh my God, let me just wake up out of this dream state that I'm in, because I'm realizing, and I mean, you know, we get caught up in what happens when we buy into all of it instead of stepping back. And I said, you know what? I said, this is all the mind. I said, we have to learn how to observe all of this. There's a reason for all of it. Every single thing that has happened, but we don't know what the reasons are in the moment. We may never know, but oftentimes I'll hear people say, for example, you know, I had a heart attack or I had breast cancer and it was the best thing that happened to me. Now, I wouldn't have said that in the moment, but moving forward, I had to go to therapy and I changed my life because of it. So many of us, when we go through something really traumatic, we change because of it. It always comes back to being connected to ourself and not disconnecting from the self. And when we buy into these dramas or chaos that's happening in our world and we buy into it, it's like we're choosing to buy into it. And we can also choose not to buy into it. And when we choose to buy into something that's happening outside of us, we lose connection with the self and we then step into overwhelm. The soul, I believe, comes in and all these experiences are laid out for our soul. And then we get to choose, okay, I don't understand. Why is my husband going through this? And why does this have to happen? Now my freaking refrigerator or my freezer is totally broken and we're trying to leave for a trip. Now we got to call the guy. I can't believe it. Da, 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 da. And it's like, hold on. And I said to her, I said this to my sister. I said, you know what? I really wonder if all of this is just to help not only you, but it's reinforcing it for me again, how important it is to stay out of the mind, stay out of the stories, and just tackle what's in front of us in every single moment.
Yeah.
When we do that, we stay connected to ourselves, and then we can use our navigation system deep inside of us to guide us to the next step. I stay out of overwhelm when I'm connected to myself and living in the moment. The moment I go into story and assumption, I'm back into overwhelm.
It's fascinating, too. Another connection to our last conversation in terms of this as a sequel. It's funny when we start to see those things, because I know I've had that thing. And it seems like everybody I talk to, when they have stories of, let's just use the freezer as an example, when the appliances go, they all go at once.
Yes.
And the fact and truth is, probably that's because you bought all your appliances at once, or they're, you know what I mean? And they, of course, they're all going to fail at once. They're sort of on that cycle. But it feels like the universe is piling up, right? It feels like, oh, this is karma. It feels like whatever language you want to put around it.
Right.
But the story that we add to that, the way we imbue those things with fear, right? It all comes from the stories that are outside of fact and truth, the narrative we create that, oh my God, I have no plan. I'm going to lose all this food. It's really expensive.
Exactly.
Do I have the money to replace the food?
Yes.
Now I'm late. I have to get new floors because the floor is soaked through because I was gone for a week. And now I'm going to miss a lot of work. And am I going to be fired because I've missed a lot of work? I mean, we will play sucker out.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that creates overwhelm. It creates panic inside.
Right.
So how do we know that when we have experiences like this happen, that they really are not just presented to us, that it's actually a teacher for us to help us to stay in witness to that mind. You know, we can look at statements like, why is life doing this to me? You know, that's very victim-y, right? Versus, I wonder, this is adult chair, I wonder why life is doing this for me. Like, what? We have a loving universe, everything in it. And even when people look awful and disgusting and they're terrible, underneath it, there's something out there that's navigating us, that's doing it for us, that's creating change, whether it be on our planet or within us. And we don't see it. Sometimes I sit and scratch my head like, seriously? Like, how is this good? And I don't need to see it. And I just trust that there is something good out there that's guiding the whole darn thing. Like, how do we stay connected? Because we do get so overwhelmed over the holidays.
And that means when those things happen, like, you know, if the, oh my gosh, the turkey's overcooked, right. You burned something. Like, those things feel like yet another bullet of evidence that the universe is out to get you.
Right.
When the reality is, as you say, it's just an opportunity to explore how you relate to these other things. So yeah, well, let's talk about ideas for kind of staying connected when you're feeling overwhelmed.
Everything is an experience, but the ego labels it as good or bad. And everything, yes. We just keep having experiences. It's like an assembly line coming by us. It's like, oh, there's another one and another one, another one. The ego says good or bad. So how do we stay connected? Well, again, this is last week's podcast or 2 weeks ago on suffering, which is observe the mind. I'm not going to go into this very much because we just did this one, but stop giving everything meaning. We give everything meaning. Again, so-and-so didn't call me back. It must mean they're mad at me. I had this example come up. I can't remember who said this to me. I think it was last year. They were so upset because everyone got invited to this Christmas party, but this one girl didn't. She could not figure out why. Why wouldn't I get invited? I don't understand. Did I do something wrong? And she went, all this whole thing. Well, so-and-so must not like me anymore. I must have done something wrong and blah, 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 blah. Well, guess what? She had the wrong address. She was invited. Yeah. So that's just an example. When we get, yeah. So she went through all this stress again. And it's like, well, I'll find out, you know, anyway. So meditate. This is, again, we've done this before, so I'm not going to go into this, but we just want to become a watcher of the mind, because when we get overwhelmed, we're buying into the stories that we're making up, and that creates overwhelm. So meditation teaches us during the practice of meditation to just witness the mind, not turn off the mind, but witness the mind. So here's some new ones, though, that we have not talked about, or that we didn't talk about a couple of weeks ago. Journaling.
Yeah.
If you're listening to the show, you've probably heard about the 30-day journaling challenge we're doing, and the comments and feedback have been incredible. People are saying, I had no idea how much I could process my life through a journal. I had no idea how much I would shift doing this journaling challenge, and they're changing. They're becoming witnesses of their minds by journaling. That's another reason that we journal. We take all the garbage, all the stories, all the assumptions that are going on and ripping around in the mind, and we write them down. And when you see them in front of you, that's when you can quite easily go, hold on a second. There's no truth in any of this. It's all a big damn story. So none of it's right.
When it's in your head, it's really easy to give it more weight.
Exactly. And the brain will never figure anything out, or the mind, it can't figure anything out. So it goes around and around and around in circles trying to figure out, why wasn't I invited? Why does so-and-so hate? It's like, no, stop. Breathing. Oh, breath work is so powerful for helping us to stay in the moment, get us out of overwhelm. Because think about what overwhelm is. Overwhelm is just when we're stuck in story land. We're just stuck. Mm-hmm. We can't get out of it. So when we breathe, so I've got on the, it's on my website and YouTube, right, Pete? Nadi Shadan. I love that one. It brings us into balance. It balances the left and the right hemisphere of the brain. I have a whole video on it. You guys can watch it. It's quick and easy.
I'll put that link in the show notes.
But you can go to the website just or YouTube, and they're there. They are in both places. But even not doing a structured breathing exercise like that, put your hand on your heart, close your eyes if you're feeling overwhelmed, and put one hand on your belly, and that connects your heart, that connects the heart with the inner child. And guess what? It takes us out of overwhelm. Slowly breathe. When we're in overwhelm, we're in the adolescent chair and our energy is moving really, really, really fast. So what we want to do is slow everything down. That puts us back into our adult. And then putting your hand on your heart and your belly connects with the child. Slow. Take like 30 seconds of breathing. Slow down, or just put your hand on your heart and breathe. It's very, very, very powerful. You can do the breath where you go four counts in, hold for four counts, four counts out. Hold for four counts. It's the box breath. So many types of breathing techniques. This is one I adore, and I do this around my house, is chanting. So everything is energy, and chanting takes a word that is filled with a high vibration or high energy. So know that negative thoughts like, I'm overwhelmed. I'm bad. I'm shame. I'm sad. I can't do this. I'm defeated. I'm victim. Whatever is a much lower vibration. If we have a scale, it vibrates. Those words vibrate very low. When we use a word and chant it, we chant a specific word that has a high vibrational state. It brings us up and out of the low state that we're in. I just did this morning actually. I was feeling like I could not focus. So I just started walking around my kitchen and chanting Om, just Om, and holding it. Om is God. I mean, hello. I really jumped right out of that lower state that I was in. We can chant words like Shanti, which is peace. So you can, and if you just want to chant the word peace, say the word peace, say the word God, say the word I am, whatever, just chant something that resonates with you, and it will help you to get out of that state. Now, this last one is a biggie because this happened last year at the holidays, and it's going to happen this year at the holidays. I don't care. Yeah. I don't care where you live in the world, this will happen. You may, and this just happened to me last week for my birthday. Actually, my birthday dinner ended on this note. You may be at a table where, and we had at my birthday dinner at the end of the night after we're all done eating, it was every hot topic, button pushing thing you could possibly come up with. And I sat there, I was like, oh my God, I'm in hell. How did this happen? And I sat there, I was like, what is going on? And I was so proud of myself because thank God I know the adult chair, because I honestly used what I know from this model to help me through this, because it was hard when everybody, and we all love each other very much, but we talked, they had Trump lovers, Trump haters. We talked about all kinds of politics. We talked about religion. We had, most of us were Catholic. We talked about some that were more spiritual, like myself. I mean, homosexuals, transgender, all of it. I mean, when I tell you, every hot topic came up, and I sat there and I'm like, I watched everything. It was really cool because I honestly did. I sat back and I watched. I watched everybody get more angry, and I sat there and I'm like, what? I said, I think I interjected one or two little things, and it was like, everyone was like red in the face and pointing fingers, and it was like, nope, this is not my scene. I don't want any part of this, too much hatred and anger. But what I was aware of is that, you know, everyone's trying to convince everyone that their side is right and the way they see the world is right. And there's no way that in that moment at that table, anyone was going to change sides, because what I saw was everyone got more defensive and they dug in. They're like little kids saying, it's mine and I'm not going to give you my little red truck. You know, it's like, nope. And they wrapped their arms around it tighter and tighter and tighter. I sat there, I'm like, nobody's going to change their opinion. Nobody. Because everyone's opinions help them to feel safe in their world. So I have, you know, two people that were there were extreme, extreme Catholics, which is fine. I love them. They're two of my favorite people. And their views of God, of the church, of religion are extreme, and they think they're right. And then there are other people that think they're right. And if we had some Baptists there and you know, Hindus, they would have, and it's like, wow, it's not about who's right and who's wrong. I sat back and observed it all and witnessed it. And there was so much power in that. But what I became aware of was nobody's really listening to each other. Listening is where the power is. So, and it wasn't the time or the place to do that, but individually it would be fun to sit. And I've done this individually with some of these people, but if you guys are having this experience, sit and listen, ask questions in a calm state as to why someone believes in what they do. We all have it at our core, at the deep, deep down core, we're trying to feel safe. And if you knew that that person believed in X, Y, or Z because they just want to feel safe in the world, all of a sudden it's like, oh, I get it. And I wasn't even mad. Like, I'm listening to these people like, gosh, they're so scared is what I looked at. I was like, they're really scared. The louder they got, the more fear I knew was in their voice. Because if they were wrong, it would shake up their whole world. I think I used this example with my best friend in Charlotte and my husband when we used to live there. This has to be like 18 years ago or so, but they used to battle about religion over dinner. And my friend one night said to my husband, You need to stop. I don't want to talk to you about this anymore. You're really scaring me. You're shaking my foundation. This is what I believe in. And you're starting to crack it. And that scares the hell out of me. And I don't want to change my beliefs because this makes me feel really safe. And he was like, oh, well, damn, I get that. So, and it was hard. I actually had to, at one point, get up, not like throwing my chair back and got up, but I just quietly kind of got up and I went and I did dishes with my cousin. And I was like, I'm just kind of done. It was getting this too much negative energy and they're so angry. And then everyone got up and everyone said, I love you. And everyone went home and it was fine. But I know that a lot of people, because I've heard it with my clients, they don't have that same experience. So walk away if it's overwhelming at the Christmas dinner or at any sort of holiday function. Don't participate. I see on Facebook, and I'm hardly on my personal page, but so many people post everything from, you know, homosexuality to politics to all of this, trying to prove their side. I'm sorry. People aren't going to change their minds because they read one thing on Facebook. I don't believe. I don't know. Maybe I'm crazy there, Pete, but we want the world to think we want to know that we're right in where we what in what we believe.
Well, and not even just right. I think it's actually more nuanced than that. And I think that gets to why we end up with this trouble at the holidays, because it's not that I want to know I'm right. I want to know I'm not alone.
Yes. We want to know that we belong. Belonging is huge. The need to belong and to feel safe and to feel validated. It's like I may believe something totally crazy, but I need you to validate me. It's like, well, I'm not. So then they get, you know, more and more angry. So don't take it personally. Again, look at these people. If you do get in a family discussion and it goes south, look at them through the lens of they're really scared little kids down deep inside. That's all it is. And when you see them like that, the overwhelm just vanishes. It's like, oh, okay. Kind of changes everything. And oh, I have a couple book recommendations that will be really helpful.
I was noticing that. You got some great book recommendations. What are these two books that you'd like folks to read?
The Peaceful Warrior by Dan Millman. This came out years ago and I read it years ago and just listened to it on audiobook again. It's just a very, in my opinion, adult chair. It's like living in your adult chair. You want to know how to do it? Go out and get this book. It's right there. The Peaceful Warrior by Dan Millman and The Untethered Soul by Michael Singer. Again, this one came out years ago. I just re-listened. I get these on audiobook now because I do a lot of driving. Mm-hmm. I just listened to this one again. Love it. He was just on Oprah, Super Soul Sunday too again. And The Untethered Soul is all about, again, witnessing the mind. How do you do it? Read that book. Very, very, two great, great, great books.
I love that you just mentioned that you get these on audiobook. It's as good a time as any to mention that Audible is a sponsor of this show. And if you visit audibletrial.com/theadultchair, you can search for either of these books. And if you sign up for a new trial account, you can get one of these books and try it out and see what you think of the Audible experience. I've been a member of Audible personally for probably 14 yeah. years. I've got hundreds and hundreds of books in my account. I love it. I swear by it. So if you're interested in another way to support the show.
It's awesome. I mean, again, I get out of the shower and I have my phone right there. I'm either listening to a book or I'm listening to podcasts. Like, it's a great time to do that and driving to work or driving to the grocery store, whatever. I love it.
Yes, it is. It is really, really good. And, you know, just as an aside, they also have this called Whisper Sync, right? And so if you are a reader and you like reading, but you get really upset like I do when you have to put the book down and get in the car, if you get the Kindle version of these books, right, the ebook version first, you can add the audio version for a pretty deep discount. It's a couple bucks more, you know, sometimes $5 or $8 more, but you get the full audio version. And then it syncs. This is like magic. It syncs between the ebook and the audiobook. So you put the ebook down, you get in your car, you plug your phone in, and suddenly you're listening to the book. You pick up right where you left off. So I swear by that. I use it all the time. Totally worth it. Anyway, that's audibletrial.com/theadultchair. We sure appreciate you checking that out. This is fantastic, Michelle. Hopefully it gives folks the protection, the confidence they need to go into the deeper holidays and survive.
Really. I mean, we need these little tools, and chanting just is so great because you can do it just for a few, like a minute, and it changes your state. Breathing, you know, put your hand on your heart, take a couple deep breaths. If you're at the dinner table and there's a crazy conversation going, take a deep breath, walk away. You know, follow your intuition. What is your intuition saying deep inside of you? I need to walk away. I need to say something. I don't need to say something. But yeah, these are all ways to stay, keep you connected to yourself. We want to stay connected to ourselves. That will keep us out of overwhelm. Overwhelm is only in the adolescent chair.
Beautiful. Thank you, everybody, for downloading and listening to the show. We sure appreciate your time and attention. On behalf of Michelle Chalfant, I'm Pete Wright. We wish you a great holiday season, and we'll catch you next week, seated firmly right here in the adult chair.